Read a brief resume in December's Parish Magazine. And if you haven't got one, Hayden will be pleased to sell you one, Patty. They're at the back of the room and they're on sale for £1 each. Is that okay? So, right, moving on. You only deliver them, you don't count. Also during November, the Society was represented at the Service of Remembrance and Reclaim, and also at the Civic Service of the Chairman of Denbighshire County Council. As Scholar Castet are undertaking a project on the Second World War, how it affected Rhyl and the evacuees in our community. We were grateful to members Chris and Julie Greer, who helped the school research the project, and along with Reg Davis and evacuee John Taylor, gave a presentation to Year 6 pupils, which was very well received. Oh, yes, and I quite forgot, and the Society funded the jam sandwiches for the day. I'm not certain if they were 1940s vintage. The Society has for some time been looking for premises to display some of its boxed, stored artifacts. Well, search over. Through the help of Library Manager Matt and Carly Davis, Museum Curator for Denbighshire Heritage Services, the first of the two display cabinets are now in situ in Rhyl Library. But don't get excited, they're still waiting to be filled. They only arrived yesterday. You know, we've been waiting for quite some time for them to arrive. We're not that quick off the mark. So, it's literally hot off the press. Just to remind you that Society's 2023 calendars are on sale tonight at £7 each. Two sold tonight, thank you very much. And I think we've got about 20 left out of the 100 that we originally ordered. They will be on sale at St Mary's on Saturday and here at the Community Market on the 17th. After our speaker tonight, there will be refreshments, so don't disappear. You needn't write this down, Paulie, you can have this. So, tonight we welcome... Oh, where is he? Oh, there he is.
I'm by the radiator.
Yes, I noticed, yes. There is terminology for that, but I'm not certain how well it would go down. our speaker tonight is Robert Jones, who is to take us for a Victorian stroll. Oh, it's gone. Along Rhyl Prom. Robert will also be back to talk to us again in February. So tonight, please give Robert Jones a warm welcome. Thank you, Robert.
I must admit, I never thought there would ever be any speaking again after COVID. And this is the first time I've spoken for about 3.5 years. And I'll be a bit rough, you know, rough. I've written my notes. I'll try not to use them, but I apologise, I will have to refer to them. Excuse me, in such a time. Can't see the notes. Hint, hint. My usual excuses. Oh, I haven't worn my glasses, but I have. Right, also this won't make sense, but at least you'll enjoy the photographs. So, stroll along the prom, and we'll start with a... We'll start by turning it on. 1932. And yeah. And it really is quite remarkable. That's its sort of ultimate development. Great big bit down the middle was known as Esplanade, and I mean you could land an aeroplane there, admittedly not a Concorde, but you could land an aeroplane there when it was originally designed because it wasn't cluttered. The sea defence from Splash Point all the way to, down towards the Vorient took 60 years to build. In fact, they've just finished it. Yeah. And that black line represents it. And if we move on from there, we can see that all the sea bit and the promenade bit, that was all never there before. And the sand dunes, which have now all gone, are where the yellow band is. And then, of course, you've got the town itself. But back in the 1890s, that was sort of three quarters there, I would say. Right, we'll look at the good times first of all. This is me and Rhyl, 1915. Yes, do you recognise me? James, much of it. I would reckon I'm scared. They were nice times, people dressed, didn't they?
Yes.
And you could park wherever you wanted. If you could afford a car. Look where the clock is. It's not there now. No, it's moved. Yes, they took it down and they moved it. It's sort of about there now, isn't it? Going on panel boats, I worked on those as a student, and then I became a bouncer in the fair, and I hid in the middle of the roundabout, and tried not to come out if possible. Wonderful, really. You've got the old Indian-styled pavilion, the floral hall. I'm going to show you some very sad photographs of the floral hall, illegal photographs. I shouldn't have been there. And then the swimming pool, the Olympic size, it's like Heidi High, the Olympic size swimming pool. And that's the Colosseum, isn't it? No, it's the gate. Toilets, remember the toilets?
Yes.
It's circus time. Remember going there and actually seeing an elephant on the stage, amazing. Next day, they took them to Horton's Nose to bathe them, and that's them coming back. Although, admittedly, that was about 50 years later. But that was the traditional thing. The elephants loved going to Horton's Nose. One year, they met the hovercraft this year. Look at that. That's coordination for you, isn't it? Or wonderful gardens in front, the mountains, it's just all there. Place worth going to. There it is again.
Space.
And there they are, they're promenading. They're walking up and down. Never went on that, very expensive tour. That's it, yeah. And you can see the old fairground behind it. I think it's a shame the fairground's gone, I like that. Green's Punch and Judy, very violent, I thought. Unnecessarily violent, as I expected. Lovely. We've got to see his friend Donkey Man later on. And then that thing, I have an auntie who used to come and visit us once a year. And I didn't much like her, and it was in great glee that I heard she'd been stranded on that thing for 2 hours. She wanted to go somewhere too. That's the view before they turn it in like a concrete canal, looking out of the Warwick towards the sea. Coming a bit more up to date now. Do you see what's on the corner? It's a clue, isn't it? Robin's Corner Cafe, yes. And there it is being built in 1938. And I mean, we were stylish in there those days. Look at that. Imagine how long that would last now if you put in there. All beautifully starched. Waitresses, they're hiding from the camera, but they're there. Robin's Corner Cafe. Bikes used to come, I was one of them. Yeah, that's the 1970s. And of course, where you've got bikes, you've got scooters. And where you've got scooters, you've got police, trouble. That's the clock before they moved it. That was part of the Marine Gardens, which was built at the same time as the pavilion. They're like shrimps. Clue dice is simple, right? top buses.
Used to be halfway down.
Nights of laughter. And that's the other one. That was open air originally, and you look down into it, and then they put that great big roof on, and then it grew grass, didn't it? I used to conduct Rhyl Silver Band in there. I'm the one that nearly drowned the band, I'll tell you about that. Donkeys again. These are good times, you've got to see some grim times in a moment. Being built, there's no glass in it. Well, some glass in it. And that's a good view showing you again the whole ensemble. Right, now we'll see some appetites. It was a heck of a job to knock down, wasn't it? You know that.
Yeah.
It was apparently going to fall down by itself, but a civic crime. Just think what it would be to us now. As I went around, I was looking for gatekeepers. Of course, we're in the flower hall. Used to play with the band there too. There used to be a macaw. And when we had a new band member, they always wore bright buttons in those days. And when we had a new band member, we would always introduce the band member to the macaw, because this macaw, you guess, haven't you? It could take off six buttons. And I would say, come on, just disbelief. So that's all these buttons would just come on. Wonderful. Very naughty. Ron Smith became the director of public entertainment or whatever. And it was his idea to fill the old swimming pool. And he put these fish in. And they were little things, and then they charged the holiday makers to come with fishing rods. And they used to feed these fish, and the fish were very good at getting the bait without taking it. And of course, eventually got bigger and bigger and bigger. And people said, well, it's very cruel, but these fish knew what they were doing. They looked back at them, you could see them smiling. And we go inside, being demolished. Yes, the old Getty. That's where the fish place is now. We're going to the fair now. Vandalism. Yeah. So the water chute ride. It was about the time they had a market there. Yeah. Now it has a name. Hang on. Sea Ghost. Do you know anything about the Sea Ghost?
No.
It was one of the little boats. It went over. Yes.
Oh. Yes, it went over in the war.
Dunkirk.
Yes.
And it just fell apart. Smash point. I used to go there and eat quite poshly. My good meals there. Susie's massage parlour, never used to go there. That's by the Palace Hotel. Was by the Palace Hotel. There's the palace before it was rehabilitated. Seems to be they're looking at it again now. Too expensive for me. Schooner. That was up by the lorry. Strange house in the middle of the car park that mysteriously caught fire one night. I shouldn't say that in public.
the West Cliff Hotel. I like the apostrophe. It was one particular tattooist, because all his parlours have that same mistake on, and probably the same mistake. And then they closed Queen Street because tiles fell off the honey club. Oh, we're over by the new distress, you'll see there. Yes? Yes. And guess what used to be at the bottom of that tower? Exactly at the bottom of that tower. The stage of the old pavilion. Exactly in the middle. And here we are demolishing the old Sun Centre. Took the brass band there so we couldn't breathe to play. Fall into demolishing the Sun Centre. And I mean, that is utter despair, isn't it?
Is that you?
No. Who said that? Normally the troublemakers sit at the back. Right, now, do you know how to promenade? Promenading, the act of walking in a public place for pleasure. The person in good health should be satisfied with a promenade of, should not be satisfied with a promenade of less than 3 or 4 miles a day. That equals up and down the entire Rhyl Prom twice every day. Even children should carry a stick. When a lady meets a man she knows, it is her privilege to take the initiative and bow first. In bowing, the head should be best at a mere lowering of the eyelids. Etiquette does not permit further nod, except between businessmen or very intimate friends. In passing and repassing on a public promenade or drive, bows are exchanged only at the first meeting. So presumably you ignore them better. I like this. This is down by Splash Point. This man is an out-and-out bounder, you can see that, can't you? They're no better, are they, really? Imagine sending your daughter to a holiday in Rhyl and you get a postcard like that. In carrying canes, umbrellas and packages, care should be taken that they do not inconvenience others. A gentleman may take 2 ladies upon his arm, but under no circumstances should a lady take the arm of 2 gentlemen. Gentlemen must walk on the outside. He's a bounder too. Look at that cane. More Chevalier. Gentlemen must walk on the outside no matter how often he needs to change sides. Married ladies must always place unmarried girls inside, not next to the gentleman. No gentleman should make remarks about ladies passing by. It was considered rude for a man to smoke in the presence of a lady, and likewise for a lady to detain a man while he was smoking. Oh. To do so would force him to extinguish a perfectly good cigar. Now here's an interesting thing. I've got thousands of photographs. I could not find a single photograph showing a man smoking in public. Oh. And tonight, you're going to see, you'll be shocked when you see it, you'll see a man without a hat. I can't remember which picture it is, but in all the photographs you'll see tonight, there's just this one, a man without a hat. I shouldn't show it. I couldn't find a single. It only became common after people saw American films in the 1930s. So you can even see that in the 1920s photographs. It's very unusual. A lady does not initiate. A lady does not initiate taking a gentleman's arm. It's old-fashioned English. The gentleman offers his right arm with the elbow bent. She then delicately puts her hand under his arm and curls the hand back over it. I'm trying to visualise that.
We'll have a go with them.
They're not drawn close by this joint, but promenade in a stately manner. A gentleman who has reason to suspect that he may be in special favour with a lady with whom he is walking may discreetly press his elbow to his side after she's taken his arm in the formal manner. If he is correct, the lady tightens her grip on his arm. If he is incorrect, she removes her hand from his arm and remarks that it's turning chilly and walks away. The lady on the left is embarrassed. Can you see that? She's hiding her face. See her bicycle? She's hiding her face. Do you know why? She's riding a bicycle. There's another one later on. She realises she's bathing. And she realises she's being photographed. She should see what she's dressed in. 1950s Rhyl, Nice View Down the Prom, 1930, showing just how uncluttered the Esplanade was. You know, it's a promenading place, isn't it? Yes. And all the hotels just ready for their customers to, their clients to spill out on. Wonderful. 1950s Rhyl, a bit more popular. Just starting to go, I would say, it's jolly old going over to many visitors. Notice the private car park just this side of the Palace Hotel.
Oh, yeah.
There we are, there.
Yeah, there we are.
Doing a roaring trade. It's probably the August bank holiday, isn't it? No yellow lines, of course, in those days. Now, let's see where Rhyl came from. Well, that's about the earliest map that shows Rhyl. It's a pile of molehills, and there it is, right at the top. Meldon, see Meldon, an important place in those days. Clefathan, Grunant, Cluid, Fluvius, Latin for river, but no Rhyl. Rhyl looks something like this. Sand dunes, salt marsh. Actually, that's over by Point of End, it would be very simple. Pasture lands very likely to flood. The River Clwyd was the great problem because even now it is always spilling over its banks. And the well-to-do who owned all the land, they wanted to do something about it. You have people like Robert Hesketh at Creek, Lord de Dogben at Kimmel, Lord Mostyn in Mossing Wall, the Bishop in his palace in St Asaph, Shipley Conway in Bodrwyth. All these people own substantial lands in Rhyl. And in 1794, they presented a bill to Parliament. The idea was to protect it with embankments and to drain it, then to divide it into plots, and then to rent it out or sell it out. And it would be self-perpetuating. There'd be a trust, the embankment marsh trust, and it would pay for itself, and they would do further work. Actually, when they first did it, they didn't do Rhyl itself, and they had to sell more shares. And those are the people who made purchases. You'll see some names there that you recognise. You've got Tarleton. He was the man who got the Tarleton Tower, haven't we, on the front there. John Sisson. Sisson Street's named after him. John Dawson, of course, was that in that. Now, like most places, there are folk tales. You know, you've got Romulus and Remus in Rome. Well, you've got Mother Vaughan in Rhyl. I'll read it for you. You can close your eyes. She's a sort of folk legend. Rhyl, its origin, rise and progress, according to the North Wales Weekly News in 1848. Few watering places on the Welsh coast can compare with the New Brighton of Wales for rapidity of growth from insignificance to importance. 40 years ago, the solitary cottage of Mother Vachanol Vaughan, which I will read form the nucleus of a now considerable town. So that in point of fact, the good lady is rightly considered foundress of Rhyl, having as good a claim to the title as Romulus had to the founder of Rome. Mother Vaughan's occupation was of a piscatory nature, fish nature, being connected with the take of salmon in the neighbouring port called Glory. Some of her customers were in the habit of coming to Rhyl at midsummer for sea bathing, and were accommodated at Vaughan Lodge, the only accommodation which the place furnished at that early time. From small beginnings, noble structures rise, and accordingly, cottage after cottage sprung up after the manner of angels' visits, few and far between. Until at length, Clithran Marsh produced a neat town with hotels as good as any in the kingdom, baths, bathing machines, a public library, and other appliances. Between 1841 and 1881, the population of the river rocketed. It went from 2,400 to 7,400. There were six reasons. The Embankment Act, which I mentioned just now, where they divided the territory up, so the landowners actually cooperated with each other. You had a new middle class who could recognise the fact that it was a good thing, and they were willing to invest their money. Some were local, and there were a lot of immigrants from North England too. There was a smooth changeover from farming and fishing, crofting if you like, over to tourism. They recognised the value of tourism. Then, of course, the great blessing, 1848, the railway arrived. And Rhyl was, they saw this, and they formed a board of commissioners. Now, this was before we had councils. There were always councils, parish councils, but before we had things like civic councils, nothing to do with churches. They formed the board of improvement commissioners, and they devoted themselves to seeing what had to be done to make Rhyl thrive. Looking at that modern map, you can see that great big blur mass there. You've got Rhyl, and Crithland was the centre. That's where the church was. There was no church in Rhyl. It was all part of Crithland. Rhyl was part of Crithland. That's the modern map, and that's the time map. Sorry, you can't make much out of it, but it shows you that whole area was considered to be the parish, and that red blob there. That's where the church was. And that's where people lived around the castle, and there was nobody over there really. Now, looking at that, just trying to remember why I got that slide there. Oh yes, this is the modern prom from the air. And if we put the tide back on top of that, we can see that the modern prom's not on it. Well, of course it wasn't there, was it? It was all sand. That whole area was sand at tidal. This is John Dawson's map from 1830 showing Rhyl. And what I did was I highlighted where all the places are where people are actually living. Those are houses. That's all there was in Rhyl in 1830. You had a road which went down towards that developed into High Street and Vale Road. And then you had another road which crossed in blue there, crossing that way, and that became Wellington Road and Russell Road, but they didn't have those names in those days. Right, the discovery of Rhyl. Well, in 1829, because they'd sold off various parts, some wise people bought part of the river and they put jetties in. And once you've got jetties, you've got boats visiting. So in 1829, the steam packet Gulliver, which was intended to trade goods and passengers between Crithland and Liverpool, arrived. And when the tide tied, went all the way up to Crithland. That was supposed to be his port, but they gave that up, they just stopped off. And a competing company, they had a steam packet called the Hercules, and it took 4 hours. And it wasn't very pleasant. You can imagine that, 150 tons feeling seasick sitting in. The North Wales Chronicle in 1830 mentioned the steamers. And it ends by saying the beauty of the scenery of Rhyl excellent accommodation for bathers has latterly rendered a great place of fashionable resort. So this is interesting. This is when Rhyl starts to be pushed. And this is the first advert that actually mentions Rhyl that I've been able to find. Warm sea, vapor baths, bathing machines, smooth sandy beach, beautiful scenery, quite picturesque. You might get seasick. of testing them in the legless, that's why, and shall be grateful for reports from those who might try. Where to stay? Well, this depends on the sort of person you are. It was a class thing, wasn't it? This view is showing you what Rhyl was like in 1840, and we're roughly where the pier was. You can see on the beach, actually on the beach, there was a baths, Bourne's Baths. And then you've got the Belvoir Hotel, and the pier was here. But notice there's just nothing in the west end of Rhyl. There's just nothing there. 1845, the Queen's Hotel has arrived. It's a middle class sort of establishment, as Basil would call it. You know, no working class riffraff here. This is a nice one now. You can see how the boarding houses and the hotels have started to arrive. The Queen's is there, there's the Belvoir, the pier would eventually be here, and all the bathing machines over there. The ladies' bathing machines were there, and the gentlemen's were there, and they actually put the pier in a certain place, exactly. But you know what they were doing? To separate one lot from the other, the gentlemen found a way around the ocean. And of course, then the railways arrived in 1848. And of course, with the railways came the riffraff. From Northern England. It was the Bank Holidays Act of, sorry, I've got myself all the twist here, go back there. It was the Bank Holiday Act of 1871, with its official holidays for all, of course, huge train loads and money to arrive. Do you know, by 1902, there were 15,000 people arriving in Rhyl on a Saturday morning, starting from 3 o'clock in the morning. And Saturday night, they were so desperate, they were sleeping in the bathing machines.
When I was a kid, in our guest house in Miller Street, we used to put a mattress in the back.
I'm going to come to that later. You can tell us about it. You moved out of your own lodging so you could get next to people. People sleeping in greenhouses and sheds in the back. Yes.
On laundry baskets.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. It was worth it too. So the station couldn't cope, so they had to enlarge it. It wasn't anything like the size it is now. All boarding houses had to be extended out towards the Vorid. They looked like factories, really. And all the land behind them became occupied with smaller boarding houses, a step down in class. These were pretty good, not near the top, we'll see those later. These were sort of in the middle. They were relatively inexpensive, and then once you got into the back streets, you went down the levels there. The biggest were on the front. These are the basic single-fronted ones on the front. And, quite Dickensian, and you can guess where the staff slept. They were tall, narrow, and Dickensian looking, especially when you remove the ones on either side. They've all gone now, of course, replaced by, yes, well, that's gone now too. But that's. At the head of John Street, there were big double fronted ones. Now, these are beautifully designed things, we'll see back in a minute. And they still exist. Their numbers were 71 to 75. And they're double. Once you go in the door, you've got a central staircase and you've got apartments on both sides. There we are. That's one single establishment there. And they were five stories high. Well, four stories and a cellar. And of course, at the back, they had something that the people who came to Rhyl had never seen before. Yes? And the people that ran them, they'd show people how to use them, of course. Because they'd be quite nervous. You know, they would tell them, when you pull that lever, the water will stop. Don't panic. So back was for toilets and bathrooms. This is an 1870 plan of the boarding houses between Water Street and Henry Street. They were mostly single-fronted, except the first. Nearest the corner, they would be more expensive. Every inch was built on. And that's that same block viewed from outside. So there's the corner. And we've got the old Boer War Memorial there, which of course has been moved twice. It was moved to the top of the High Street in 1928. And then it was moved again, 1948, over to near the lifeboat shed now, the other present day Garden of Remembrance.
I'm not sure I saw that, just at the top of, well, as in the first picture, when I was a kid, that must have been imagined.
Well, those are the days we moved. You can see all the hotels along the front, and then as you go further back, the properties become smaller and less expensive. So there were properties on River Street. They didn't have this in those days, they had something else.
That's St. Edward Street.
Sorry, what is that St. River? St. Edward Street.
I was born in River Street.
River Street's the next one, I just got one out of my. There we are, River Street. Lots of cars to be seen. What was it? Gas lights. Something quite fine, even though it's regimented. And then we get on to Abbey Street. But when we look at the other way, we realise just how many shops there were on Abbey Street. And there was a time when it was thought that Abbey Street might actually become the High Street of Rhyl. It really was that sort of level of competition. Right, now some people wouldn't stay in places like that. They needed something posher. They would go to a private hotel some upper middle class. And then we come into the region of hotels. It's a 1927 advert for the Palace. We're getting progressively posher. Marlborough. So we're on East Parade now. And there it is in 2016. It's still quite recognisable, especially the one on the end. I'll go back. And then. Yes, still quite recognisable. Going higher now, the Belvoir, and the Belvoir hotel people owned the pier. And then there was the Westminster. parts and tower in the distance. Are you ready? Do you know where it might be?
Queens.
And it really was a showpiece. Later on, it had the sort of amusement section added onto it with the dome and the famous Venice. But let's go into the Queen's Hotel. There's the entrance. You'd need a team of maids dusting night and day, wouldn't you? Dining room. It was a showpiece. Nothing in Tlantico could compete with it. Something to do with the man that built it, as you'd see. Well, that's a private sitting room. He wasn't silly. He also realised he had to bring in street trade. So down on the bottom floor, he had windows and people could see him. And I mean, you couldn't invite the Titanic. You couldn't get from there to any other part of the hotel. This was for the passers-by, provided they could afford it. But they would never have seen anything like it in their life. Right, now we're really, well, do you know where it is?
Is that the government? No?
But see, they've got one now. But in those days, it was called the Claremont Hydro. It looks like this now. You've got one now. But that's where that used to be. And you would arrive with your butler and your maids, and there'd be butler's rooms. You know, you bring your coach with you. It was like a stately home holiday place. I expect most of the people arrive by private train. The Rhyl Journal always used to carry a panoramic photograph of the Rhyl, and they used to change it. Put that in the look. Put the wrong over time. There we are. Let's see what we can recognise. First of all, that is 1889. And the pier is. Women's out, we'll show it again. Right. So the pier was complete. That is the old baths that used to be on the seashore. That's the Coast Guard watchtower, bandstand, ladies bathing, gentlemen's bathing. I'll show you where they put the telescopes later.
They were the courting places.
That's it, yes. Very severe penalties if a gentleman was found on that part of that picture. And then they changed. The baths disappeared. And the watchtowers disappeared. And look, a great big wooden pavilion. And that's, of course, the one that is going to burn down. And they built this new place now and named it, was it 1892 or something. Changed again, jump forward another few years, and now it's a bit difficult to see. There's the dome of the Queen's, that's arrived. The wooden pavilion's gone, replaced by some very impoverished structure. But life goes on. Prestatyn Weekly had its own version, but the quality is dreadful. Look at the quality of the engraving. Just get the view as well. Now, what did you do? Right. Activities, what do people expect? Sands, bathing, boat trips, variety, gardens, sandcastles, donkeys, minstrels, Punch and Judy, German band, they will all go. Paddling, ice cream, yuck, want to see what they ate. And of course, the pier. But most of all, it was eating sand, I suppose. That's what I remember about going to the beach, and all the butties with sand in them. There is the wooden pavilion that burned down. And it's just all sand. There's a bell wire. Same for you again, just a bit further back. All the usual pursuits, building sandcastles. It's probably a bitterly hot day, isn't it? The man in the middle is like the kind of the captain, you remember the old matchbox? Captain Webb, was it? Bathing was daring and expensive. Most people just paddled, rolling up their clothes. Bathing was daring and expensive. Bathing machines had started appearing in Rhyl in the 1830s. The ladies' bathing machines were in front of the West Parade. So there they are. Bathing dresses were just what you might expect, but even then it took a lot of nerve to wear them. A gentleman bathed in front of the East Parade. I won't show you the men's costume because it didn't have any. I will if you want. Bathing has of late been carried out most vigorously, and the bathing machine proprietors must have reaped a good harvest. We are glad to see that some persons are at length making a complaint about what has long been a crying evil in the town, and which the commissioners might remedy with a stroke of a pen. We refer to the fact that men are allowed to bathe on the machines without any dress whatever, and that within hail of the pier, which is supposed to be a pleasant resort for ladies of all ages. It is quite time that ladies should be able to walk upon the sands and upon the pier without being subjected to these annoyances. And we hope the board will take action at their next meeting. But so, this gentleman used to hire out his telescope. And then people used to arrive during the holiday season selling these. So each well-equipped lady or gentleman would be wandering around, they had their obligatory stick, but they could look through it too. My family, I quietly strolled onto the water edge this morning and pitched my chairs for wife and family in a line directly fronting the fountain, at least 60 or 70 yards away from the bathing machines, when to my surprise I was accosted by a police officer and informed that gentlemen were not permitted in that part of the beach. May I ask for the guidance and information of visitors like myself, what are the bylaws or regulations prohibiting any of the male sex from walking upon or taking a seat upon the beach, keeping a proper distance from the ladies' bathing machines? I am given to understand that there are some peculiar instructions to the police at Rhyl, but under what Act of Parliament can they order one to move on in the past convention? And he was a justice's clerk. They were sexless. Bathing machine attendants had to be tolerated. And they were okay. They were invisible as far as they were concerned. I do notice these issues treading on dangerous water. Provocative lady there.
Yeah.
He's the man who owns the bathing machines. And then there came up this marvellous invention where you don't need a bathing machine. I don't suppose we've ever seen in Rhyl. It's probably out of Punch magazine. That's 1858. And of course, bathing machines became the target for homeless people. A woman here, Margaret Price, wife of John Price, was brought up in custody, charged with sleeping in the bathing machines without any visible means of subsistence. P.C. William Hughes said that it received complaints from Mrs. Parry about people doing damage to the bathing machines by bursting the door to gain admission, and blah, 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 goes on. The ladies' bathing machines in the 1870s stretched across the West Parade. That's a proper photo, not just a drawing. And those are the gentlemen's photo machines. That's the lifeboat shed. Mm. And it's exactly where the bottom one is. Mm. And do you remember, you might know there was a disaster off the Point of Air. Not the Point of Air lifeboat, that was another disaster. There was a real lifeboat disaster. I think five were lost. And that photograph was taken out at the time of that. Jane Martin was the real lifeboat at that time. There she is.
Is that what they call the banana boat?
Yes. The sides were about that thick and they were full of capon, which is like a life belt, an old fashioned lifeboat flotation substance, a bit like a cork. They were death traps, absolute death traps, and they were so brave, and they were rowing out in the incredible weather. And then, of course, they used horses to pull them in and out. Oh, this is the lady who's just seen the camera looking at her. Those are the first drawings of donkeys on Rhyl Beach. And they're being ridden on, but that wasn't their main reason. There they are again. That was their main reason. And of course, when they weren't being used for gathering cockles and so on, they didn't rest them. They had the visitors riding them. That's it. How they originated. side saddle, ultra safe ladies contraption there. I'm sorry they're very blurred, but these are really very, very tiny images from much bigger. Mm-hmm. Lovely photograph. Let's see what we can see. First of all, a shooting gallery. The targets are in those little hut-like things. Mm-hmm. And you went in this bit here, and you got your gun, and you shot down the tube. That's the donkey stable. There had been an act of parliament which demanded that donkeys be protected from bad weather and the sun, so it had to be built. That's a photographic studio. This, what do you call it? It's got like a table and a mirror on top, and it can rotate.
Camera obscura.
And you'll notice that it's the ladies' bathing area again. And you see the toilets, they're exactly where the toilets, they've always been there. There's the Queen's Hotel. It'll be marked down. Close up. Tried to get him off the beach, but Ken Jones was. And his family had been running donkeys on Rhyl Beach since 1848. He died in 2012, he was 80. He had 30 donkeys, and he had taken over the business in 1945 with his brother Ted. And at its peak, he had 75 donkeys on the beach. Divided into three lots. One lot down by Splash, one lot up the other end, and one lot in the middle. But there we are. That's just about the last day that he did it. It was 1868 when it was new. This is 1890, strolling down the pier. The sun's immediately overhead, look at the shadows, non-existent. A very hot day, so they're fully dressed, of course. There used to be a railway going down the pier. You could just see the lines. It was a bit like a horse carriage running on rails, but they got rid of it in the end. It was hand push actually. And that's looking back from the refreshment bar back towards the Belvoir. 1870s. It's a bit difficult to see, but just there, that's the top of St. Thomas's Church. It's not got its spire yet.
No.
You can just see the tower, the little parapets on the corner. There's no spire. 1870. And then halfway, not quite halfway along the pier, there was the Bijou, the little pavilion. And you said, well, there are Negro minstrels and banjo players and so on in there. We've arrived at the landing stage now, looking back, and St. Thomas has got its spire. And here are the trap doors that they would open for you to go down the steps to get onto a boat when the turn. Times down. Like a kind of thing. And the camera's turned around now. ship did go through once with that storm damage. That's 1909. And then they came along and repaired it. And then there was a fire. It was in the fortune teller's kiosk. She hadn't anticipated that. Of course, the one thing that gets all peers in the end is neglect. It got shorter and shorter. Hokey pokey man. That's a hokey pokey man. Ice cream. Served on a kind of a goblet. And what you do is you paint your penny, they call them penny licks, and you licked it off, that was it, and then you'd use it again.
Oh.
There is a man selling ice cream, see?
Yeah.
What is going, what's he thinking? What does he do? Where's he come from? What's his last year been like? He is either, he's either in ecstasy and just can't believe it, or I don't know.
Charlie Chaplin.
quite a few of these are my own postcards. I've never seen them sailed anywhere. Oh yes, Victorian ice cream. Wonderful stuff. These are some of the things that the public, this is a Rhyl public analyst, what he found in Rhyl ice cream. Because Rhyl used to be plagued with outbreaks of diarrhea. one of the cures, was they used to sell a kind of a tincture with morphine in it, a dose of that, and you didn't know whether you were coming or going. Hotel on the beach. It has now become a children's hospital. Let me see if I can give you the date. Uh, 1873, it was sold to the children's hospital. They did a lot of work to it. They attached a very fine chapel. Here we are. Can I draw your attention to the style of it? And the ironwork and the roofs, you start to think. There's another view, and that is the fine chapel they built. Yeah. You've got it. When they moved, they didn't leave it behind. There's the Alex. Can you see the similarity?
Yeah.
When they said, right, we're going to have this wonderful, beautiful new hospital, and we wanted to be a bigger version of the same thing. And if you go around the back, there is there's the comparison of the two.
Yeah.
And if you go around the back, you can find the chapel. It's still there.
Yeah.
They took it apart. They took it apart.
Yeah.
There's the grand pavilion, the wooden pavilion that burned down. building. Only lasted about 10 years. It was built in 3 months because it was wood. That's probably the best surviving photograph of it. That's the Coast Guard building again, viewed from inland. And that's the Great Fire, burnt down in 1901. And Rhyl didn't have a big building anymore. And that's the reason why they built the Queen's very quickly. And that's a blow up from the front of the Rhyl Journal of the Queen's section. You can see the dome has been forced in onto the old etching. It doesn't really quite work. The dome was glass, and inside it had dozens of electric arc lamps with big reflectors, and it could shoot light out, and it could be seen from, the sky could be seen lit up from Liverpool, the whole sky. Mm-hmm. And the joke was in Rhyl, they knew when the Queen's was opening at night because all the lights in your house would go down. Because all the electric was generated by the Rhyl Council. And they really struggled. They were continually at war with the council, wanting to have bigger and bigger cables, more and more electric. It's a story of its own. It was a phenomenal place inside. And Venice really did exist. Mm-hmm. And you may have seen it mentioned in the press lately. There were people who doubted and say it was small and so on. I have completed a book on it and I got the plans, which I suppose not exist. It was enormous. It had 12 gondolas in, 12 ten-seaters. They were bought from an exhibition. It had 15 gondoliers. There was a lot going on down there.
The blokes who were putting it down, though, I asked them if they found anything. They said no.
Well, no, they wouldn't have been filled in because it was after the fire. And what people seem to think, what we don't realise, it was in the cellar under the ballroom. And they built a wall in the cellar, and they filled the inside of the wall with waterproof material, and then they filled the inside of that. Mm-hmm. They didn't dig down, you see. That's inside the ballroom. And the theatre that perhaps many of us will remember from the 1950s and 60s, it's not the same theatre. The original one was absolutely and completely, totally destroyed. There's nothing left of it. The arcade survived, largely, but the fire originated under the ballroom floor, and the ballroom floor was a sprung wooden floor. Mm-hmm. And what happened was that they'd had electrical work done. They were always changing the electrics because they were always upgrading. And they were altering, and eventually they had such a big electrical machine that they had to move it because it was bothering the people who were hiring spaces in the arcade, and they put it under the ballroom, and there was no firefighting because they had water pointing downwards, but once the floor was set on fire, the water was going upwards, so the fire spread through the floor. And then because you had a tower with big glass dome, it acted like a chimney, mm-hmm. and all the hot air was drawn up and the glass broke, and it became a fiery furnace. There was nothing we could do about it. There was a lift going up to the top. This is the arcade before it was opened. This is 1902. That's it's open. There were 32 shops. And then up on top here, there were glass, there were windows, and there were tropical gardens on either side. could see the glass windows there. Through there and down was the shopping place, and there was one of these on each side. Later on, they had a native village, and a lot of people suggested it was up here. It wasn't. It was down where Venice had been 2 years earlier. That's the following morning, and the Queen's Hotel was largely undisturbed. That's it. And that's inside the arcade we saw earlier. That's the Conway Memorial Fountain from 1846, and that's exactly where they put the clock tower when they put it up in 1946. And the Conway Memorial Fountain was taken back to Portrithen. And we're looking here off towards the west. Now I have a reason. If we look in this area here and magnify, something going on there. You can see there's a wall. There's some kind of building there. This is the Rhyl Winter Gardens. There are no really good photographs of it. That's the main entrance on Wellington Road, which is opposite where Aldi used to be. Is the concert hall, and then there was supposed to be an equal wing on this side. It was never completed. And here you have to this day a place called Lake Avenue, and people assume it's to do with Marine Lake, but it's not. It's the lake that was built for these gardens. So it was a lake, terrace, bandstand, skating rink, grotto, aviary, tennis courts, pavilion, grand parade, seal pond, recreation ground, switchback railway, cricket pitch, football ground, cycling track, conservatories, monkey house, aquarium, palace theatre and ballroom. And if you want to see all that's left of it, you go to Lake Avenue, go down with empty bins down the back, and you'll find some of the external walls are still there. It lost everybody a lot of money. You know where you are? The pavilion. The old pavilion with a big dome on it. Exactly where the Sky Tower is now. And it was planned with marine gardens and bandstand, completely enclosed, very classy. Bill was never the same again after that. There they are, they're getting ready to go off to war. And that's it.
Really good.
I think there was something for everybody in there, whether you were 70 or 170. So if Methuselah's in, you enjoyed that. Thank you, John.
Robert.
Robert, even.
John, if you want.
Little something for you.
That's all I came for.
Thank you. And two cups of tea, he said.
I don't like the tea.
Before Hayden draws the no expense fair raffle, I would on behalf of the committee wish you and your families a very happy and peaceful Christmas. Nadolig Fawen of Lyddon Lair. Thank you for your support during 2022. Just to remind you, moving into 2023, that our first meeting is on the 6th of January here, and we will have an illustrated tour of St. Asaph Cathedral. You won't have to travel, you can stay here. So, over to Hayden. We've got lots of prizes, it's almost like a bar at the back. And as I said, after the draw, there are refreshments which you can collect from the hatch.
Right,
so it's 61 to 65. Well done.
Well done.